Hey, 42 here. What if I told you that 8% of your DNA isn't actually yours? What if I said it was given to you by a strange, almost alien life form? One that still lives amongst us right now? Don't worry, I'll explain all in just a minute. But first, I want to ask you a question. Imagine you wake up tomorrow morning and turn on the TV to be shocked by the breaking news that every virus in the world has been eradicated. How would you feel? I'm willing to bet you'd be somewhat elated. In an instant, you'd be free of the fear you've held in the back of your throat your entire life. That you could catch a killer virus, Ebola, HIV, influenza, the list goes on. You might merrily skip outside and give the pavement a good lick, and maybe your neighbour's face for good measure, safe in the knowledge that no ill can come of your reckless lickathon. But what if I told you that your relief would be replaced with dread in the coming years, as a series of unexpected but deadly consequences arise amidst this new virus-free world? What if I told you that you'd soon be begging for the return of those once maligned pathogens? Don't believe me? Watch until the end of this video and you'll discover why eradicating viruses could be the biggest and last mistake we ever make. Viruses are everywhere, and I don't mean like pret-a-mangers in London everywhere. I mean that viruses literally cover every inch of our world, from the deepest depths of the ocean to the highest mountain peak, and from the most barren deserts to the densest rainforests. There is no corner of our planet where viruses cannot be found. They're in every breath you take. Korean scientists tested the air in a forest and found that each cubic meter of air contained up to 40 million viruses. That fact might make you feel icky and only give rise to your desire to eradicate them from our planet. But don't be so hasty. You should be grateful for those gross organisms to which you're playing host. Because without them, you probably wouldn't be here right now. In the grand tapestry of life, viruses have not just been a thread, but a master weaver, intricately shaping the very fabric of our existence. It's a story that begins at the dawn of life itself, in the murky primordial waters of ancient Earth. Viruses, in their simplest form, are genetic material encased in a protein coat. They are so primitive that they straddle the line between living and non-living, unable to reproduce without a host. This ancient survival mechanism suggests that viruses may have been amongst the first forms of genetic material, possibly co-evolving with the earliest forms of cellular life. I remember one time I was fishing on Lake Guntersville in northeast Alabama, when suddenly this walleye with an attitude was on my hook. It near enough pulled me into the lake, but I grabbed my rod and managed to reel a Teflon troublemaker in. It was one of my proudest moments. Oh, wait, sorry, that actually happened on Fishing Clash. It all just felt so real. Fishing Clash brings the world of fishing right to your couch, and I mean the world. You can cast your line on the coast of Florida, the Amazon River, Loch Ness, Cape Town, the Nile, and so many more. And to make things even sweeter, or saltier, I suppose, is the expansive variety of different fish you can catch at each location. I always need my game to have a competitive edge to keep me coming back, and Fishing Clash brings this in boatloads, with events happening daily and weekly, and leaderboards to keep on top of. I particularly love the PvP duel mode, which lets me go head to head to see who can catch the most and biggest fish. If you're just starting out and not catching fish as big as you'd like, I'd recommend purchasing power-ups in the shop. My favorite is the luck power-up. Oh, and don't forget to improve your lures to catch the best fish. By leveling up your lures, you also level up, meaning more fish and more fun to be caught. Download the game by using my link in the description box below, or scan the QR code you see on the screen and use my special gift code, Fish with Arran, to get a special $20 value award, including a unique avatar for free. In Earth's early life soup, viruses played a unique role. Gene mutations can happen vertically, when genes are passed from parent to offspring. But viruses are special in that they enable horizontal gene transfer. Think of them as couriers, carrying tiny packets of genetic information from one host to another. This process would have catalyzed the evolution of early organisms, increasing the diversity and speed of the evolution process. And this same process went on to affect the evolution of larger organisms, such as insects and animals, later in Earth's timeline. The evidence of viruses' ancient origins and their role in shaping life is etched into our very DNA. I mentioned at the start of this video that 8% of your DNA is not yours. Well, that 8% is composed of endogenous retroviruses, remnants of ancient viral infections. So viruses have made us who we are today. We don't know how humans would have turned out without viruses, but we'd be radically different, if we existed at all. And it's not just animal life that has reaped the benefit of what viruses have sown. They've played a pivotal role in the evolution of plants. Plant viruses have shown to confer resistance to certain pests and diseases, improving crop resilience. Without this, modern-day plants might be too weak to survive in our changing world, and we might have succumbed to famine by now. So, by this point, I'm probably changing your view a little on viruses. But let's still answer that question. What would we have to do to eradicate them all, and what would happen if we did? Let's start with the how. Eradicating all viruses would be an undertaking of unprecedented scale and complexity. It's not just about developing a cure or vaccine for every known virus, which in itself is a close to impossible task. No. It's about completely removing every single viral particle from every corner of the planet. From the depths of the oceans to Taylor Swift's underwear drawer. That's right, it's going to be a huge challenge. Imagine nanobots capable of identifying and destroying viruses at a molecular level. Or perhaps some form of global atmospheric filtration system that could remove viral particles from the air. We'd need similar systems for water and soil, of course. Then we'd need to purify every living organism, which could be done using some mythical super vaccine, providing we wait a generation or two for all the current carriers to die off. But even if we could develop a universal vaccine for every known virus, it wouldn't even scratch the surface. For a start, we only know about a fraction of them. Highly speculative estimates put that number at about 1%. So 99% of all viruses are unknown to science. Then there's the fact that viruses evolve constantly and rapidly. Besides, say you had this magical vaccine. How the holy hell are we going to inoculate every living thing? It's not just humans, everything would need to be inoculated. And I mean everything. Can you imagine trying to chase down 20 million ferrets to stab them with needles? If such a vaccine was created, let's just assume that it can adapt itself to all unknown and future strains of viruses. The most effective method of disseminating it would be by spreading it throughout the global water supply. That way, it would eventually make its way into the water cycle and rain down on crops, which would be eaten directly or indirectly by almost every living creature. Now, this is obviously grossly oversimplified, and the reality of such an operation would be insurmountably complex. But let's just say, for argument's sake, that we manage the impossible. We inoculate every living creature. We get out the Dettol and scrub every rock and every leaf. We purify every particle of air using the most advanced graphene filter imaginable. You get the idea. After doing all of this and a lot more besides, planet Earth is officially 100% virus-free. What happens next? At this point, it would be an appropriate metaphor to say that our species has now crossed the Rubicon. Because for reasons that will soon become clear, there is no turning back. We have no choice but to march on a squeaky clean Rome. But what will be awaiting us? Will it be a virus-free utopia or a vision of hell? Initially, it might seem like heaven. Imagine waking up in a world where the constant threat of viral pandemics no longer looms over humanity. Gosh, the news might have to talk about something interesting for a change. Hospitals and healthcare systems will be relieved of a significant portion of their cases. No more HIV, flu, or hepatitis. The psychological impact would be profound. Without fear of contracted illness, socializing would feel easier and physical contact would be employed more liberally. Just imagine being able to take the tube without worrying if every ruddy-faced traveler around you is carrying a dreaded cold. People would take fewer sick days, resulting in a worldwide productivity uptick. Without livestock contracting viruses, the global food supply would become more stable and slightly cheaper. And perhaps the greatest benefit would be that without viruses to worry about, medical research could refocus all of its attention on curing non-viral killers, such as cancer, dementia, and other genetic diseases. But as the initial wave of euphoria fades, cracks begin to appear in our virus-free utopia. The first sign of trouble comes from the natural world. Without viruses to keep their populations in check, certain species of bacteria start to proliferate uncontrollably. These bacteria, once harmless, become opportunistic pathogens, causing outbreaks of diseases we've never seen before. Our antibiotics, already stretched thin by years of overuse, prove to be utterly ineffective against these new threats. In the oceans, the absence of marine viruses destroys the marine food web. To give you some kind of idea, every day viruses kill about 20% of all bacteria in the ocean. And all that dead bacteria provides a food source for microscopic marine life. And that's a delicate balance you just don't want to upset. Phytoplankton, usually kept in check by viruses, now blooms uncontrollably, leading to the depletion of the ocean's oxygen, creating vast dead zones where no fish can survive. Suddenly, a primary source of protein for billions of people around the globe is threatened. Furthermore, phytoplankton acts like a carbon sponge, absorbing CO2 from the atmosphere. Therefore, a huge algae bloom could reverse the greenhouse gas effect, causing the climate to rapidly cool. Some of you might think that's a good thing. After all, isn't that what every politician and Swedish teenager has been banging on about all this time? Well, not quite. Because not only would the algae absorb CO2, it would also increase the albedo, that's the reflectivity, of the Earth's surface. Which means more solar energy would be bounced back into space, so the Earth absorbs less of the sun's heat. The result could be a runaway cooling event, paving the way for another ice age. On land, ecosystems begin to unravel in alarming ways. Insects, crucial for the pollination of countless plant species, are severely impacted. Without viruses to naturally regulate their populations, species like the aphid explode in numbers, leading to widespread crop damage and a disruption of the natural food chain. In humans, the consequences are equally dire. Our immune systems, having evolved in a world teeming with viruses, begin to malfunction. Without viruses to train and regulate our immune responses, we see a rise in autoimmune diseases. Our bodies, lacking an external enemy, will start to attack themselves. Conditions like multiple sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, and type 1 diabetes become rampant. Now, you've heard of the human microbiome, but have you heard of the virome? There are strains of viruses inside you and on your skin right now that have been with you your entire life, your silent passengers. We think of viruses as bad, but most of the viruses in your virome are harmless and even beneficial. They influence your microbiome and complement your immune system by reducing populations of pathogenic bacteria and harmful viruses in your body. So getting rid of your virome would have profound and untold consequences. But the most alarming effect of all, at least long-term, comes in the form of genetic stagnation. We think of evolution as a slow process, taking place over millions of years. But a significant and sudden change in the environment, like removing all viruses, would cause all living things to exhibit noticeable changes within just a century or two. Of course, animals with shorter lifespans would be the first to exhibit change, but given enough time, human DNA would also adapt. Future generations are born into a world where genetic diversity is severely stagnated, making our species more susceptible to new diseases and environmental changes. In a cruel twist of fate, humanity realizes that in its quest to create a virus-free utopia, it has instead fashioned a fragile world teetering on the brink of ecological and genetic collapse. The irony is not lost. In our attempt to outsmart nature, we have only underscored our own vulnerability. And in pursuing a perfect world, we lose sight of the imperfection that made our world perfect. As I already mentioned, scientists think that viruses have been on Earth since the dawn of life itself. So, to boil it all down, We just shouldn't mess with what's worked for billions of years. Okay, we've screwed up. Crop failures are leading to mass famine. We've just triggered the new ice age and our bodies are attacking themselves. Can't we simply tuck our tail between our legs and retreat back over the Rubicon? Can't we simply reintroduce viruses and hope ecological balance is restored? Well, there's a reason I described eradicating all viruses as crossing the Rubicon. Because there is no way back. At least, there's no easy way. Especially if we're sans viruses for a prolonged period of time. The longer it is, the worse it will be upon their return. It's not just a matter of sprinkling viruses back into the atmosphere and the oceans. The ecological systems, having developed for decades without these viral regulators, are no longer prepared for their reintroduction. To take just one example, if we reintroduced the viruses that previously controlled aphid populations, aphids, now with weakened immune systems, might experience mass die-offs. And that would be bad. Although a pest, they provide a vital food source for many small predators. A similar outcome could happen in the oceans. Phytoplankton, having bloomed uncontrollably, might collapse suddenly, leading to a catastrophic breakdown of the marine food web. The climate, having cooled, would now shoot in the other direction without phytoplankton to suck up CO2, triggering a runaway global warming event. The global agricultural system, already reeling from pollinator collapse and crop failures, would have to adapt yet again to a new set of challenges. Healthcare systems worldwide, already burdened by a rise in autoimmune diseases, would have to deal with a new wave of viral illnesses. And that's only the beginning as far as us humans are concerned. Decades of our viral-mediated gene transfer has left all species, including us, with reduced genetic diversity and untrained immune systems. Especially for the next generation. In the 1980s, the hygiene hypothesis was formulated that states babies who aren't introduced to pathogens will grow up with severely weakened immune systems and at a greater risk of allergies and other autoimmune diseases. It's the classic, a little dirt never hurts anyone argument. Reintroducing viruses into such a population could be disastrous. Viruses that were once relatively harmless could become lethal. It would be reminiscent of when the Spanish brought smallpox to the New World. If you thought coronavirus wreaked havoc in 2020, just wait and see what happens when a similar virus is let loose on a population whose immune systems have just awoken from a 100-year siesta. Okay, so lastly, I just want to point out that a lot of the hypothetical scenarios I mentioned in this video are highly speculative, despite being drawn from current scientific understanding. Did you know that viruses are by far the most abundant biological entity on Earth? So trying to predict what would happen if we removed them from our world and then reintroduced them is such a dense and complex task that there is literally no supercomputer or AI model in existence that could attempt to do it. For everything that is affected by viruses, biology, the climate, evolution, there are 100 other contributing factors and more besides. Viruses are just too intrinsically woven into the makeup of our planet and our history, and the history of every living thing. All I do know is that we should wish for their removal at our peril. Except for SARS-CoV, that can f*** off. Thanks for watching. Thanks to Fishing Clash for sponsoring this video. Download the game by using my link in the description box or scan the QR code and share your biggest catch in the pinned comment.